لله الحمد لله وحده عدد خلقه وزنة عرشه وكمال كلماته الحمد لله ناصر المستضعفين وقاهر المستكبرين نحمده ونستعينه ونعوذ به من النفس الأمارة ونعوذ به من وساوس الشياطين ونعوذ به من كيد الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله مالك الملك علام الغيوب ذو الجلال والإكرام عز شأنه وتعالت حكمته وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وعزيز نفوسنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم من يطع الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فهو على صراط مستقيم ومن يعص الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فهو في ضلال مبين أما بعد Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims. There are two surahs in the Quran, among others, the two surahs that can be described as military surahs. We know this wording is not comfortable with the image makers and the propagandists in the world around them. But the truth has to be said. These two surahs are Surah Al-Fath and Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Military surahs. Combat surahs. It's alright. Those who are going to be disturbed and nervous about this, so be it. That's the nature of the surahs. If they have any other ideas or any other words or comments, let us hear from them. No one's around. One of these small discourses in Surah Muhammad, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon him and his, says the following. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ والله يعلم متقلبكم ومثواكم. This ayah is saying the following. Be informed. Be advised that there is no deity / authority except Allah. And ask for forgiveness pertaining to your mistakes, and for the committed Muslims, males and females. واستغفر لذنبك وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات والله يعلم متقلبكم ومثواكم. And Allah knows your equivocations. Allah knows your conditioning. Allah knows your vacillation. And He knows your abiding and your status quo. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ مُتَقَلَّبَكُمْ وَمَثْوَاكُمْ. ويقول الذين آمنوا لولا نزلت سورة. فإذا أنزلت سورة رأيت الذين في قلوبهم مرض ينظرون إليك نظر المغشي من الموت مغشي عليه من الموت فأولى لهم. Okay, please bear with me as I try to explain this ayah. ويقول الذين آمنوا لولا نزلت سورة. Those who are committed to Allah will say, remember, this is a military atmosphere here. We're not speaking about Muslims who have confined themselves to a few square feet in a masjid or in a place of worship somewhere. Speaking about here, people who are thinking about sacrificing their lives and their limbs. People who are potentially going to die, giving the most precious that they have for Allah Jalla wa Ala. So it is to be expected, according to our reading of this ayah, that committed Muslims would want clarification on some of these military issues. وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَتْ سُورَةٌ. Those who are committed to Allah will say, if only a surah is brought down to our attention, so that they will know what to do in the circumstances of life and death that they are in. ويقول الذين آمنوا لولا نزلت سورة فإذا أنزلت سورة محكمة وذكر فيها القتال. And if a surah with clear meaning doesn't tolerate a range of interpretations, the meanings are straight, direct, clear, explicit, explained. فَإِذَا أُنْزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ مُحْكَمَةٌ ذُكِرَ فِيهَا الْقِتَالِ. A surah in which issues of combat decisions, combat efforts, combat sacrifices is brought to their attention, they now understand its meaning. رأيت الذين في قلوبهم مرض ينظرون إليك نظر المغشي عليه من الموت. فأولى لهم. You will see those who have a disease in their hearts, they will look at you, O Prophet of Allah, as if their eyeballs are turning in their eye sockets because of the fear of death. Which behooves them. Which is what they which is how they initially react anyways. فَأَوْلَى لَهُمْ. Listen, are we listening? Anyone out there tuning in to these meanings? Once again, because they're absent. These meanings are absent. Their applicability is not explained in today's tons and volumes of Islamic expressions and literature and public discourse. وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَتْ سُورَةٌ. This is natural. Those who are committed to Allah, as the circumstances begin to unfold in a war atmosphere, now tell me, we're not living a war atmosphere. Whoever of us in today's current events doesn't feel and sense that we are living in a war atmosphere, maybe living on another planet somewhere, or is not in full control of their senses and their common sense. Okay, we ask for direction from Allah. Oh Allah, could you reveal to us some information concerning the circumstances and the challenges that we are living in? وَيَقُولُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَتْ سُورَةٌ فَإِذَا أُنْزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ مُحْكَمَةٌ ذُكِرَ فِيهَا الْقِتَالُ. And then, when a discourse of information, a surah, is made accessible to them, having no questions about it, a compact, a clear set of meanings that they can understand. فَإِذَا أُنْزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ مُحْكَمَةٌ. This is not a surah mutashabiha. We're not speaking about some ayat here that are going to be explained in the span of coming time. We're not speaking about ayat here that give our intellect, our faculty of thinking, a room for reasoning, a range of meanings. No! There's a direct, incontrovertible, solid meaning to the directions and the meanings that they were asking for. فَإِذَا أُنْزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ مُحْكَمَةٌ ذُكِرَ فِيهَا الْقِتَالِ. In which fighting is mentioned. In which combat is mentioned. In which warfare is mentioned. ذُكِرَ فِيهَا الْقِتَالِ. رَأَيْتَ الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَيْكَ نَظَرَ الْمَغْشِيِّ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ. You will see those who have a pathology in their psychology, those who have a disease in their heart. What are they doing? They will look at you, When these ayats come from Allah, and in these ayats there are answers to their questions, you are asking for clarification. Allah is giving us this clarification. You have an enemy, you fight your enemy. And they are startled, and they become nervous, and they feel like they are at the end of their lives. Their eyes begin to turn. ينظرون إليك نظر المغشي عليه من الموت. The way they are looking at you as if it's a dying person. There's a distance here. There's no longer a connection. A person, when he or she dies, you see that they are no longer in contact with you. They begin to disappear. You can sense that by looking in their eyes. This is the way they are looking at you, O Prophet of Allah. And everyone who speaks the language of the Prophet of Allah. ينظرون إليك النظر المغشي عليه من الموت فأولى لهم. What else could you expect from them? This comes from them naturally. It's the first thing they express. Now we're not speaking here in an ivory tower somewhere. We're speaking in the real world. What is this ayah saying to the real people around, those who brag about being Muslims? Okay, let's look at ourselves. There are Muslims in this world. There's been a recent poll. They counted there's 1.68 billion Muslims in the world, and they're counting. We don't believe their count anyway. But this is by their own tallying of the Muslims in the world. Almost 1.7 billion Muslims in the world. And they said they were surprised that there were this many Muslims. If they're telling us that there's that many Muslims, and they tell us also that there's about 2.2 billion Christians, we don't know how they came up with these numbers. The most fertile areas of the human population in the world are the Islamic territories and areas. We've been this way as long as we can remember. And the least fertile are those who call themselves Christians. And they still outnumber the Muslims. They're still playing this number game with us. But this information comes from them. And then we make believe we don't have any enemies. How long can we continue to fool ourselves? How long is it possible, when we have wars in our lands, military bases all over our countries, Muslims being killed left and right, how long can we continue? When we come to Jumu'ah prayers, when we listen to the Khatib, when we attend lectures and sermons and presentations all over the place, how long can we continue to avoid mentioning the fact that we have enemies? This is an elementary truth. And we've been avoiding this all along. If we can open our eyes up and look at the real world, how we are bleeding. Anyone deny Muslims are bleeding? In Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, of course this wasn't on the front page of your major newspaper, but in the course of the past couple of weeks, almost, There have been a couple of hundred Muslims forced to be inside al-Masjid al-Aqsa. And around al-Masjid al-Aqsa are those Israeli Zionist enemies of Allah and His Prophet and the committed Muslims. This is supposed to be the first Qibla and the third Haram that we have by the consensus of all Muslims. What are we doing about this? What is anyone doing? The Israeli Zionist enemies, eternal enemies, they are building tunnels under Masjid al-Aqsa. And all the speakers from all, practically, all the manabir in the Muslim world, as these developments have been going from one stage to the other, everyone's making believe that we don't have enemies. What is it going to take for a Muslim to personally feel that he has real and bloody and criminal enemies? What is it going to take? You want that enemy to come personally to your home? You want that enemy to displace your family and your relatives so that you can begin to think that you have an enemy? It's not enough that they have done this to the tens of millions of us. When is it going to dawn on us that there are enemies and we need Allah's directives and direction as to how to deal with this enemy? So when this information comes to us from Allah, some of us begin to reflect an image of a dying person. Why, what's wrong with you? Everyone wants to go to Al-Jannah, but no one wants to die. Have you thought about it? You say you want to go to Al-Jannah. You hear all of these ayahs and all of these ahadiths about Al-Jannah. But you don't want to die? This is our problem. So when this critical information comes to us from Allah saying, well, you're going to have to fight. There's no other way to deal with this type of bloodthirsty, bloodletting, bloody enemy. There's no other way. So you see those who have an ailment in their internal selves, they begin to reflect the impressions, the picture of a dying person, as they should. It takes this type of responsibility, this level of sacrifice, to expose these types of people. Brothers and sisters, we have real enemies, and we don't want to be silent anymore. This silence is literally and practically and generationally killing us from generation to generation, from country to country. We are being physically liquidated, killed. And we are silent about this because no one wants to say Muslims have an enemy. Allah is telling us this fast. We read this, but no one wants to understand it. The example of Al-Masjid al-Aqsa is only one example. How come these Muslims in Palestine they go and they face up to this very sophisticated war machine with their bare hands. They don't have much. What do they have? Some stones? This is at a time when people who are speaking about Islamic solidarity. The word Islamic solidarity, al-tadamun al-islami, was coined by the late King Faisal of Saudi Arabia. In the first Zionist attempt to destroy al-Masjid al-Aqsa, there was a fire there. This is about 40 years ago. And so this king called for an Islamic conference that would result in Islamic solidarity for the purpose of al-Quds and al-Masjid al-Aqsa. What do we have today? We have these rulers in that same country, in that same piece of land. His brothers. What do? They're busy going to the nightclub and the nightlife of the casino, the gambling, the fornicating areas of the world. You think these people think that they have enemies? They buy weapons systems and never use it. And these weapons systems that cost the Muslims, they pay for it out of the budget and the treasury, or the treasure of the Muslims themselves. From the 1960s to the 80s to the 90s to today, how many weapons systems have they bought and have become obsolete, which they never use? And if they ever thought about using it, it would be against us. These people, do they know where their enemies are? And you try to put them into order, put them into shape, bring them the meanings of this Quran, and they will begin to look at you just like the ayah described them, with their eyeballs turning in their eye sockets as if they are in the throes of death. يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَيْكَ نَظَرَ الْمَغْشِيِّ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ. All the news that comes from that part of the world, as if it is news that comes from the darkest corner of planet Earth, such as the son of the late King Fahd, the guy's name is Faisal, Al-Amir Faisal. What's the news about him nowadays? He wants to buy a football team in the United Kingdom. Yes, it's called Liverpool. Liverpool has a debt of almost $500 billion. I don't know, running around $400 million. Now he's interested to go and buy that football team that is going under financially. Can't that wealth, can't that money be used in more brotherly causes, for more brotherly interests? As if nothing is happening in Palestine, nothing is happening in Yemen, nothing is happening in the Muslim world. The first thing on his mind is to go buy a British football team. This is the type of news that comes out of that country. You want to know another news item that doesn't make the headlines here and there? A Saudi individual appears on television and he begins to speak about his sex life. And it was broadcast on Arab satellite stations, one of them LBC, the Lebanese Broadcasting Corporation. And then when it becomes a scandal in that kingdom, they do the same thing he's doing. But he's not supposed to say this in public. So what do? They say, we're going to lash this person 1,000 lashes. And we're going to put him under some type of confinement for 3 years. Prison or house arrest or whatever it is. This is the type of news that comes out of there. Another type of news that comes out of that land of darkness. It's a land of light. But they have rendered it a land of darkness. Another type of news item that comes out of there is they inaugurated a university just a few weeks ago. And that university has students who are males and females in it. And we begin to have a protest. How come males and females are coming to the same university or the same classroom to obtain knowledge? You begin to think, how do these people think? All of their mind, all of their thinking is in their private areas. There's nothing in the world except the private area of a human being. There's nothing else. That's the type of news that comes out of that forsaken family government. At a time when the enemies of Allah ask their scholars, Bani Israel, the Zionists, Al-Fahayla, the Israelis, are they not the eternal enemies of Allah? Ask your scholars, and verbally they'll tell you yes. But practically, what are you doing about this? They have, in that same Arabian Peninsula, in a statelet to their east, called the United Arab Emirates, they have, this is, maybe one day we will begin thinking, instead of coming to these khutbas and to these sermons half awake, half conscious, half minded. These things are happening on our own watch. The United States government has a consulate in Dubai. And what does it do? It gives visas to those who want to come to the United States, which is what consulates do anyway. But what is this particular one doing? It's looking for Iranians who can inform and spy on their own people, on their own country, on their own government. And so, it interviews some people who want to come to the United States, and if it finds that they are willing to cooperate, gives them visas. But the United States is beginning to feel an economic crunch. They're beginning to think that we have to close some of these consulates around the world. So one of the consulates they want to close is the one in Dubai. The State Department thinks that this is no longer something we want. We have to save some money. And then the CIA moves in and argues against that and says, no, this is an important consulate because through this channel we are recruiting some spies for the national interests of the United States. You tell me, these are not people who are working against us. What do you want spies for? Why, we ask, why do the United States want to become, as a government, as a military establishment, why does it want to become enemies of Muslims? An enemy of Muslims. Why? They're peaceful people. We don't have any 10,000 nuclear bombs and warheads. None of that. The only thing we have is an Islamic government and system that wants to gain peaceful nuclear technology. And all hell breaks out because that is the case. These are not dummies. There's a plan. There's a strategy. How long are we going to continue to be deaf, dumb, and blind to the plan and the strategies that they have? And why is it that some Muslims begin to faint or show symptoms of death when they are told the only way to deal with it, told by Allah, not by some strategist or think tank or ijtihad, words directly from Allah. فَإِذَا أُنزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ مُحْكَمَةٌ ذُكِرَ فِيهَا الْقِتَالُ رَأَيْتَ الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَيْكَ نَظَرَ الْمَغْشِيِّ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ فَأَوْلَى لَهُمْ. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. ادعوه سبحانه وأنتم على يقين بالإجابة وتوبوا إلى الله إن الله تواب رحيم. بجميع المحامد على جميع النعم، صلى الله وسلم على المبعوث خيرا ورحمة وهدى لكافة الأمم محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Brothers and sisters, committed Muslims, we would think that we, the readers of the Quran, and the behavior duplicates of the Prophet, we would think that there are more important issues to deal with than reacting to our own self. This is what we're doing. Basically, the khutbah that you just listened to is a sad comment and is an explanational reaction to our own selves. At a time when Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, another piece of information that may not be well known and that shows you the difference between the layer of parasites that have grown on the body of Muslims in the world. These are the rulers. Where they are and where we, the average, the normal, the regular Muslim is. During the time of Yasser Arafat, when he was head of the Palestinian Authority, the foreign minister of Turkey, a guy by the name of Ismail Cem, comes to him and he says, I want to speak to you personally. I don't want anyone to listen or know what I'm going to say to you, except for the translator. So he dismisses everyone. This is Arafat, who was playing tootsie, dancing with the enemy politically. So the foreign minister of Turkey says, I have come to you with an offer, and that is to permit the Israelis to build a small synagogue on the area of Al-Haram al-Sharif, what the Israelis call the Temple Mount. Just permit them to build a small synagogue there. And in exchange for that, you will have whatever is required. Independence, sovereignty, the financial help coming to you from all directions. That is the only thing. No more settlements, no more refugee problem. All the issues are going to be solved. You just permit them to build a small synagogue virtually next to a Masjid al-Aqsa. And as compromising as Arafat was, and we've spoken about him and about these issues in that time frame, so don't anyone here come and say I'm trying to build up Yasser Arafat. He said, I'll accept. We have no problems with that. Provided I ask you to go back and consult your own people. If the Turkish Muslim people accept to have the Israelis build a synagogue on this area that you are speaking about, where Masjid al-Aqsa is and Qubbat al-Sakhra is, then I will accept that. And then the Turkish foreign minister said to him, consider this conversation never took place. I never suggested anything to you. You never responded to me. And the whole issue was over. This is the distance between those who rule and those who are being ruled. The dictators, the tyrants, the despots who are getting away with all of these political shenanigans. And we who are building our self-determination block by block and step by step with reliance upon Allah. This Jumu'ah, word went out and I don't know how far it got. Supposed to have been dedicated to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and Al-Quds by these Palestinians there who are under siege. Reminds us very much of the condition over here. They had the overwhelming force. They put us out of the masjid. That's what they want to do to the Muslims in Al-Quds. They have the overwhelming force and they want to put the Muslims forever outside of the masjid. How many people do you think responded to this call, to this SOS by the Muslims in occupied Palestine and in the stolen Holy Land? How many do you think respond to this? We don't know, but we know that this determination to move ahead has begun. This is the climate of our time. And those who refuse to see these facts, the United States military and government have been sinking deeper and deeper in Iraq and Afghanistan because they refuse to see, to acknowledge the climate of the time. And we continue to build one step, one effort at a time. And Allah will be with us as long as we are with Him. Allah will support us as long as we are supportive of Him. إِنْ تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَكُمْ. رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا سَمِعْنَا مُنَادِيًا يُنَادِي لِلْإِيمَانِ أَنْ آمِنُوا بِرَبِّكُمْ فَآمَنَّا. رَبَّنَا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. ربنا وآتنا ما وعدتنا على رسلك ولا تخزنا يوم القيامة إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. ربنا صل على محمد وآل محمد
ربنا صل على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم، ربنا بارك على محمد وآل محمد، ربنا بارك على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها، أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين، لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون، يعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور، يعلم السر وأخفى. أقم الصلاة وأرحنا بها.